Okay, so welcome back, and this is sort of the last topic officially under the umbrella of image processing that we will be covering. And few advanced topics in terms of convolutional neural networks is left that we will be taking up in the next week. So so far we covered sort of different types of segmentation. Of course, as I said many times, it's not the exhaustive list. My job was just to introduce you to a variety of topics. And this sort of is a nice conclusion to even the segmentation process. Okay, so I'll explain to you the reason. So many a times you might have come across this sort of aspect in, let's say, textbooks, where you scan the textbook or you take a photo of the textbook. Many a times what happens is like you have letters which are not continuous like this, for example. So there is letter E and A which are sort of discontinuous and it doesn't look appealing to the eye. In fact, this sort of situation actually happens in many of the segmentation scenarios also. So what I'm saying is something like this. Okay, so let's say after segmentation, okay, so this is my overall image. After segmentation, I got something like this. Okay, so this is the region and there are certain spots which are dark. So let me just put the entire background is sort of dark, okay, and then the inside is supposed to be white, but there are regions which are actually having holes, and you really don't want that, right? You want the entire region to be actually having same uniform intensity, okay? So that's a objective. Or maybe some scenarios like this. Okay, so it's something like this. Okay, maybe that's not the right way. Let me just draw it more accurately. Okay, so what I meant is something like, let's say I have a blob. Okay, so it's supposed to be a circle. I mean, something like this. But then there's another one also here. Ideally, this would have been something like two distinct circle with a gap, the dark gap here. But somehow they get fused together. So you want to separate them out. So all these operations are sort of post-processing. Okay, so you have this to start with. So binary sort of image to start with. Okay, so it's not really an image per se. It is a output of a segmentation algorithm or a thresholding algorithm or a black and white image or a more like a logical image like this, which is the input. And the next step is actually for us to make it better. Something like I want to link these gaps here to make it much better. And that process is known as morphological operations. And it actually get inspired from the concept of set theory, because morphology is about certain sets, right? I mean, in Max, morphology theory is all about set theory, okay? So we will leverage from that and explain what exactly is it. It's very simple. It's not really complicated algorithm to really get worried about. So what essentially the operation means is you have a background image, which is a binary image, as I said, okay? And then we define certain structuring elements, okay? So I'll explain to you with example what these structuring elements look like. So it can be any shape. It can be a square. It's like a kernel of a filter. So it can be any shape. So it can be a square, circle, or diamond, or cross, or it's a rectangle, or something known as a very small element. And that element will be used to either fill these gaps, for example, or remove certain connections together. Like I said in the just before I talked about two concentric circles getting overlapped, right? So you want to separate them out. So you basically sort of want to create a gap between them. So for that purpose also, we use something known as structuring element, okay? So there are two fundamental, just like filtering. In the case of a spatial filtering, what two things that you have are the original image and the filter kernel, right? Similar to that, for morphological operations, what we have is actually, of course, the image, which is a binary image, and we call it as foreground pixels, okay? In the sense like those which are having intensity 1 will be foreground pixels, remaining is background pixel, right? 0 is background pixel. And then the second element, just like the kernel in the filter, is a structuring element, which can take any shape, which is determined by you based on your viewpoint of the final application. Okay, so let's actually discuss in detail exactly what I meant. Okay, so the I will introduce to you basically two fundamental morphological operations, and there are many, many such operations possible, and I will also show you a list of them. But the one which are most commonly used are erosion. As the name suggests, we will erode the image, so there is a lossy operation going to happen. And the other one is known as dilation, which is like diluting the image, so it is like increasing the extent of the image. So the name itself conveys what exactly I meant. So let's talk about erosion. So mathematically, it means something like this, okay? So A is the original image, the starting image, the binary image, and B is the structuring element. So A, we are eroding B from A, okay? So what does it mean is exactly as this equation, and don't worry about it if you don't understand. It's as simple as if the B fits in A, we consider those pixels in the final result. If B don't exactly fit in A, if B is completely a part of A, okay, when you place the kernel B along the each and every pixel in the image A, if B exactly fits in that image, then that pixel belongs to that image. We can keep that image. Otherwise, you discard that pixel or you make it zero. So that's what exactly I mean. I'll explain. Don't worry. Okay. So this is what exactly happens. So literally, if you want to say, so A is a set of foreground pixel of the original image having intensity 1. So I don't place when I said each and every pixel of A, don't worry about it, because what we are only worried about is the high intensity or the one value or the 255 values in the image. Remember, A is an image which is a binary image, which will only have 0 and 1 or 0 and 255. So when I say exactly A, you don't really need to place it on each and every pixel of A. Only consider those pixels which are 1 or 255 valued pixels. And when we place the B structuring element, if the B exactly fits in, okay, the entire B has to fit in. Otherwise, it won't work. So I'll explain, okay? So let me take the example. So application-wise, erosion removes thin lines, isolated dots, and leaves only gross details. So let's take this example, okay? So this image, I put it on a grid, an overall grid, something like this, and a structural element is looking like this. So in this case, the structural element is like a cross. So this will be zero. In terms of values, this will be something like, okay, so this is a kernel, okay, so don't worry about it, okay? And this is the image. So this is the holistic picture of the image, and only these regions are actually one, okay? So this is one, this is one, this is one, and this is zero. That's what I mean. So now let's do this operation. So what I'm going to do is, I'm going to place this guy on, basically the center of this is of course this. We are going to place it first here, okay? So because that is a most intensity pixel. But it doesn't exactly fit in, right? Because this guy are out, right? I mean, they are not really, when I place this, so what I meant is I place the cross like this, right? But then these are outside. They are not exactly fitting. That's what exactly this equation means. The B has to be fitting in the A. So that means this guy, I mean, basically this doesn't fit. So you can ignore it. This, I think all of them doesn't fit, right? I mean, if I keep this guy centered in each of these, it doesn't fit. Or maybe rather I will put which all elements shall fit in. Right, in the this cross exactly fits in here, because you can see the cross automatically here, right? So cross exactly fit in, the closest point is that. So this will be selected, this will be selected, this will be selected, this will be selected, this will be selected. What about this? Yes, this can also be selected, and this cannot be, because if I put a cross here, this guy goes out. So this can be selected, this can be selected, this can be selected, this and then what about this? Yes, this. So I'll just finish it off. And that's exactly, so this will be the result of this operation. And that's what exactly showing over here. Okay, so just to reiterate, erosion is a process involving your background image and a structuring element. The shape of the structuring element is purely determined by your objective. You should have a vague idea of how to go about it, choosing the structuring element. So if I choose a structuring element like a cross and use it on this image, I get something like this. So you can see over here, the image size is reduced to a finer size. So this can be used to remove thinning, isolated dots can be removed, and so on, right? So I hope you got the clarity on this. And implementation per se, it's quite straightforward. Okay, so I'll show you the implementation after maybe explaining this application. Okay, so this is the wire-bound image after the edge detection or the filtering and thresholding operation. You have that. This is a binary image. And if I use a structuring element, which is like a rectangular grid, okay, this 1, 1, 1, 1, okay. So if I do that, okay, I get this, okay. If the size of the structuring element is just 2 by 2, it's 1, 1, 1, 1, I get this. If it is actually 15 by 15 ones, I get this. If I get 45 by 45, I get this. So you can go from here to here in a very beautiful way using this process of erosion. Okay, so I hope it's very clear, and let me explain the code part to you. Okay, so let me just show you that. Okay, so we will read the image, and then you can actually decide the size, the structuring element size, as simple as this. Okay, and now what we essentially do is we go through each and every pixel. Actually, you don't need to. You can actually go through only those pixels which are high intensity value. But for the sake of simplicity, let me actually put in terms of each and every pixel. And then what we do actually is we take 3 by 3 or whatever number here. So 11 by 11, right? This is 11 by 11. So 11 by 11 neighborhood we take. Okay. And then we will see which one of them are actually ones. Okay. So which one of them are actually ones in that sense. Right, and then we just need to see minimum, right? Minimum, because if at least one of them is zero, if in the neighborhood when I put the structuring element on centered around a pixel, if at least one of the neighborhood is zero, that's what essentially we take by minimum, because minimum will go to the minimum value, which is zero or one, right? And out of zero and one, minimum value is zero. So if one of them is zero, that means the entire pixel, that pixel is discarded because it's not exactly fitting in. So it's very simple. The operation is very quite straightforward in the sense like you try to see the neighborhood 11 by 11 in this case around the pixel, right? Around the center pixel. And if at least one of them is zero, then of course that means they are not fitting in. That's it. Right? I mean, it's quite straightforward. Okay. Anyway, I'll pass you the code so you can actually work around it. So I just run it. And this is what actually happens if I use 11 by 11. Now let's actually see that 45 by 45 case. And you can see over here, this is the effect. Okay, so it's quite straightforward. So what we essentially do is actually erosion is just minimum, and you can already see it. Dilation will be this one changing to max. That's the only change you need, okay? So let me go back. Okay, so this is what we have. And now let's actually talk about dilation, which is just the opposite. And let me just write this up. So what essentially this happens is, here the structuring element is again placed on each and every pixel of A. Okay, and if there is an intersection, that means if the structuring element is actually, if one of them at least, okay, so one high element of structuring element is having an intersection with A, high element in A, then you will include the entire thing into A. So that means you are going to expand, right? So that's exactly what means. And of course, erosion will help you in expanding things. An example is over here. So you have a square image to start with. I use a square element itself. D by 4 is the extent. D is the total. So D by 4 is the extent. So if I put it across, then you can see over here, this dotted is the original dimension. And you can immediately imagine, right? Let's actually put this way. I'm sorry. Okay, so what is essentially happened? Let's say I'm putting this kernel, the center over here. Then it looks something like this, right? And then in the case of erosion, we would have actually discarded this entire this pixel, right? Because it's not exactly fitting. But dilation is the opposite of that. If at least some portion, this portion is covering, right? If some portion is covering, that means I will extend this also, and this also belongs to part of this image. And that's how you arrive at this particular image. Okay, similarly, if I use a structuring element which is of this shape, then this image will get changed to this. So you can control, right? I mean, that's the beauty about it. And now you can think of this problem which I introduced to you in the beginning of this lecture. So this image, okay, if I take a structuring element which is something like this, again a cross, I get something like this. And you can immediately see the difference between these two, right? And let me just go back. Okay, so let me go back and show you the dilation aspect. Okay, so the same thing, the only difference here is max. Okay, max means at least one of them, right? I mean, you have so many zeros and ones. If one of them is one, that means the entire thing is included. That's a concept. Okay, so if I run this, you can always see it, right? I mean, you can control the thickness, okay, control the kernel and see for yourself what all things will be making the difference. I hope this is an interesting topic for you. Okay, so that's it. So let's move on. So we studied about two different types of operation. One is erosion, the other one is dilation, right? And there is a relation between them also, just the opposite of it. And now the interesting part is you can combine them. You can combine erosion followed by dilation, dilation followed by erosion, and so on. So they are known as opening and closing. Okay, so I'll just straight away go to the topic. So opening means you are first going to do erosion and then you do dilation. Okay, so as the name suggests, you're opening something. So you need to go erosion first, destruction first, and then construction. Okay, so this can be used to break narrow bridges and eliminate structures. Okay, just like I told at the start, you have two circles which are sort of very close to each other. You want to increase the distance between them, you can use this sort of operation. And closing is just the opposite. You do dilation first, followed by erosion. Okay. So this is to break narrow bridges, this is to fuse narrow bridges. Opposite, just the opposite, right? That's all. So this is a beautiful example. So you have an original image which is looking like this. And now let's do first this operation, which is actually basically erosion, right? You're going to erode, that means my structuring element I'm going to choose is sort of this shape, this circle shape. So you start with this, so then it's not exactly fitting, so you remove it. So your final shape looks like this, okay? So from here to here, if I do A eroded with B, B is nothing but I end up in this, B is nothing but this circle. This is the structuring element, right? And then what I'm going to do, use same structuring element, I'm going to do dilation. So this is the starting point. If I do dilation, this is a process going to happen and the final image will look like this. And similarly, the same image, if I do dilation first, it looks like this. And then erosion, it looks like this. So you can see the difference. Let me just highlight those things. So this is basically the opening process. You can see over, this is opened, this bridge is opened. And this is the closing process where these narrow boundaries are closed. Right? So beautiful applications. And I want to quickly motivate you with one of the most widely used application in the case of fingerprinting. So you have the original image here, A here, you have the structuring element which is here. If I erode it, you have it here. Then what you do is you do dilation. So this is basically the opening, okay? So this is the opening part of it, right? So many of these things are gone, you can see over here. All the spurious things are completely gone. Right, and after that what we do is actually okay, so this is the opening part. And then you again do dilation just to increase the size. You can see over here. And then what we do is an erosion on that. So again, you do erosion. So from here, you achieved here, right? And you might be wondering, oh, it's very difficult. Yes, this is all intuition driven, your objective driven. What is your final objective? You have to tune it accordingly. Even the choice of structuring element is purely based on your knowledge of your final objective. Okay, so what is your target? Okay, that's the thing. And another example is the boundary extraction. Okay, so this is one thing where we used it for removing the spurious peaks and making it more uniform. Another example, I think this is one of the beautiful examples, you may be using it many times, is actually to extract the boundary. So for example, you may do a thresholding or you may do a graph cut algorithm to find the background and the foreground. But I'm more interested in extracting that boundary. Okay, I'm not really interested in the two regions. Instead, I want the boundary of which is separating the background from the foreground. So you can use this sort of thing, for example. So this sort of approach where original image and then you erode it, some structuring element from the original image. If you do a subtraction, you get the boundary. Straightforward. So let's say this is original image, this is your structuring element. If I do the erosion, I will end up getting something like this. If I do this minus this, I get this one. So you see over here, the boundary is beautifully extracted. Right? So you can, I mean, maybe I'll illustrate using this example. So you have, this is a background for you, this is the foreground for you, but I'm more interested in finding the edges. So what we need to do is, you take a structuring element, something like this, and then you do this operation, which is actually nothing but erosion. And then you subtract from the original image, the eroded one, you get something like this. And this is very, very important, right? I think I have the code anyway, I'll share with you regarding this. Okay, so I hope you appreciate the process of this morphological image processing. Even though it looks very simple, a lot of places it's really going to be useful. So just to reiterate, what we did is we take the binary image, which is our sort of the base image, and then you use a structural element, purely structural element, which is purely designed by you. Any shape you can take, any dimension you can take, and then you do process like erosion or dilation or even a combination of them to come up with various applications that we discussed. And if you think that erosion, dilation, opening, closing are only possible, no, there are many such operations possible, and you can actually, it's quite self-explanatory, most of them. And many cases, something like convex hull, for example, somewhere here, is heavily used. Okay, so hit and miss transform, for example, they're really used, and you can see it's all based on purely the basic operations that we discussed. And even the operations like translation, reflection, all these things can be expressed in the morphological terms. If somebody is really interested in expressing everything sort of set theory, please feel free to refer to this slide. Okay, so this is it. The exhaustive list, actually, we really don't need to actually study or by heart all of them. It's all based on your application, but just always have all these things in your back end, in your mind, that all these are possible. Okay, so sometimes before going to the neural network or machine learning possibility, explore these physics driven, image processing driven approaches, because they don't really need a huge data set to start with. Okay, so with that, it's sort of officially winding up the essential part of image processing course. Most of it is covered. Some few advanced topics, as I said, maybe I will put video lectures later, which you can always come back and refer, but that's not part of the course. And only one portion, which is advanced portion, which is an entry point to sort of computer vision, is left. In fact, segmentation is an entry point to computer vision, but as I said during the introduction part of this course, without convolutional neural networks, maybe modern day image processing is not complete. So we will have a quick overview of convolutional neural networks with applications from classification and segmentation in the next week. And that sort of concludes the entire lecture series. Okay, so I'll upload all the codes. In fact, a dedicated hands-on session is not needed in any of these advanced topics, because sophisticated codes are already available in Python and MATLAB packages. And if you want to build from scratch, you are free to do it. But our code may not be as efficient as a MATLAB or a Python code to start with. The moment you understand the algorithms behind all these concepts, then it's very easy for you to actually use all these codes. Okay. So with that, I will wind up this week's lecture and see you all in the hands-on session on Monday. Until then, it's goodbye. Thank you.